Thanks so much. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a regularly scheduled meeting of the Sunderland Board of Selectmen. If we can call to order at 6:36, that was Jennifer Uncles going by. We have three important pieces of kind of strategic business here tonight. The first is, of course, the 120 North Main Street has been, a working group has been continuing to work on development RFPs with the help of COG. COG's here tonight, Alyssa's here tonight to talk to us about how the RFP is developed. This is part of our public forum process. And then Library Director Catherine Hand is here to talk about a strategic plan, a long-range plan for the library, which frankly, you know, there's been a lot of discussion about, and it's nice to see it kind of come out of the trustees and participants realm and into the public forum. I think that's a wonderful thing. And then Dan Van Dalston's here. He wants to present us with some amazing something for the 300th anniversary that, frankly, the board doesn't even know yet. So we'll all be in for a surprise. Before we get on with the actual meeting tonight, I'd like to remind everybody that we participate in a larger concept called the United States of America. So be respectful to each other. And frankly, in that respect, it has to be omnidirectional. That's respect all the way around. Respect for government, respect for individuals, respect for the rule of law, and in the case of authority, the respect of the citizens. That's my official piece on what's going on in what feels like unfortunate tension in our country right now. So, David, any comments?
Well said, I agree.
All right. Our innocent, sorry.
with that note.
The best, by far and away, it's actually a really funny line. The United States of America can still elect an innocent individual to office. It's a really interesting line. I think it's hilarious. That said, I'd like to thank the COG as well as Alyssa specifically and her director in the Housing and Planning Group for the fine work that's gone on with not just the 120 North Main, but our long-range plan, our housing plan. We've worked together now for a couple of years specifically and directly, and that's really been a wonderful output of our work. Our housing plan has been updated. This 120 North RFP, I think, has a little bit left to work on. That's what the public input is for. And with that said, I want to, again, offer my thanks for the work that the folks at the COG have done for us. And at this point, if you could hand it over to Alyssa. Talk about the RFP. What's okay. going on? How do we do?
Okay.
It's going to cost $7 billion. And
no.
Thank God.
So first of all of you probably are aware that the 120 North Main Street Advisory Committee has been working on this for quite a while before the RFP, and so I know that there were public forums and that went on about conceptual designs for the property and things like that. So I'm just stepping in at this point to kind of help with the next step. And Sherry helped with getting a grant through the Department of Housing and Community Development to hire the Council of Governments to help the town with developing a request for proposals to find a developer for the site. So we've met a couple times. I've met a couple times with the committee. We started with a template that was that Sherry had provided, and that the state has provided for this type of project, and then we've gone ahead and modified it as the town saw fit. And I've also been consulting some with the Massachusetts Housing Partnership, Rita Farrell, who works out of an Amherst office for them. That's a state housing agency, and they actually fund affordable housing projects, and they have a lot of expertise and knowledge in affordable housing. And so a couple of staff there have reviewed the RFP and provided input and comments, and so we've incorporated that, which I think is important because the world of affordable housing is quite complex. So this has gone through a couple iterations, and I believe, Sherry, you sent it around for review.
We sent it around to all the departments to request that they review it and make any comments and attend the meeting tonight, so I can see that there's quite a few here.
Yeah. Yes.
So I just wanted to back up for a minute and say that when we last had a public forum, which was last October, we presented the results of the feasibility study that has been done by Berkshire Design and the market analysis that had been done by LDS. And at that point, I think we had a design that people were fairly happy with. And again, that was very preliminary. So we don't, that wasn't an architectural design, that was a concept, but it was a direction to move in. And we had the financial information, which basically said that the size of the project and some of the constraints of the property, we had a project that was possibly marginal in terms of being profitable for someone to invest in. So the committee, with Sherry's help, we were able to get help writing the RFP, and I think the basic decision of the committee over the last several months was, let's move ahead with the RFP process, because really we're not going to know. This is the way to know that whether we have a viable project, or that we could keep spinning our wheels. But essentially, since we're not going to be a developer, we kind of need to get this out there. And one of the reasons we've asked to have a meeting with everyone, glad to see everyone's here, so I know we have a few questions specifically on things in the RFP that have possibly a planning, zoning, conservation, element to them that we want to make. We want to make sure everyone's on the same page before this actually goes out public, yep. And we're, committing to someone. So that's kind of how we all got here tonight.
Great point, Lauren. Thanks for the synopsis.
So, I mean, should I provide any more information, or should we just open up?
I guess maybe the first question would be to have folks who are on, not on the 120 North Main working group, seen the RFP. I know the CPA met last week. There was some discussion about elements of the RFP and how the CPA plays into that. Again, to tie into Lauren's synopsis, make no mistake, a project like this, even at 22 or 23 units or 17 units, it is essentially non-conforming inside of our zoning bylaws right off the bat. It's also important to bear in mind that a project of this style in that location likely is going to be falling under the 40B rules. And our goal would be to have it be a friendly 40B with both a designer and developer. We actually had a fair amount of conversation and consternation about, is it design developer? Is it designer architect where the funds are fronted by the town and we present this out to the world and maybe it can or can't get built? Or is it going to be a hybrid of the two? Is there a development team that can come in? And it's important that the working group has had a pretty steady stand about wanting to have a seat at the table, in particular for the design component. Let's be candid. We don't want a 14-story vertical column by Frank Gehry out there. As much as I like Frank Gehry, that said, twisting stainless steel might not look quite so well. We want to ensure that there's a fit with the town center. It's an attractive space for utilities, transportation, commerce, culture, libraries right around the corner. The readership will go up by fivefold just by, 22 families moving in right there, or 22 seniors moving in right there. They'll run out of coffee on Friday. That said, it's important that it fit in the community. The design component, unfortunately, we also give up in some ways with the RFP and the designer process. So trying to ensure our input is really, really important. Another piece about the RFP is that's simply the request for proposals. Mm-hmm. They're gauged based on their scoring metrics that's developed. There's a whole other stage that goes on with this. Nobody's signing any contracts. This is casting the net to see who's interested in this project as it's defined in the RFP. I think the economics they're always difficult. Economics, you know, the economics is centered around what can be perceived as winners and losers, right? Somebody either made a ton of money and shafted us on a lousy job, or it was harmonious and we're all happy. Well, it's still economics when all said and done. So the economics in and around this is largely grant-driven, agency-driven. I think it's been described before as the acronym soup of agencies. Everybody's had that bowl of alphabet soup? No, there's an agency or 12 in there. That's probably where we're going to be ending up. It's also important to bear in mind that the long-term management, when we talk about building is one thing. Long-term management is something very, very different. The town has been pretty clear, and certainly this board has been pretty clear, we're not interested in having a housing authority in town. We're not interested in the real estate business. We're not interested in any of that. It's not our job to create a housing authority in the town of Sunderland. Someone may think it's our job, but I don't think that's the sentiment of the community for 22 people. It's not that easy to do, as has been described with our folks from the COG and the DHCD. So I wanted to piggyback on to Lauren's, a nice synopsis on that for the next steps. With respect to the RFP itself, Richard, you had talked earlier, you and I spoke downstairs about the dollar transfer as being an area of concern, and rightly so. The question I have for Alyssa and for Sherry is that consideration something that's integral to the RFP at this point, or is that the second stage with respect to negotiating with the developer designer?
I think that if you know that you want to convey it, mm-hmm. For essentially nothing, a dollar, then I think that's helpful to be clear about in the RFP. But if that's not the case, you're not sure, then you can always, I think I've seen it worded, you know, that you can basically ask for what they would be willing to,
it's a measure of compensation.
Yeah.
Okay.
Also remember that the work done by LDS basically shows that the developer doesn't spend any money on the property.
Right.
I think if you're concerned about, you know, having a feasible project, offering the property at no cost is a nice incentive to get towards that. And it doesn't necessarily even guarantee that it'll be feasible, but it's a way to certainly help in that direction.
Stuart, you've seen in the past on housing projects where they go out and land is a contribution component to the mix?
Yeah, a couple of those, and certainly seen that.
Okay.
And not to get too far ahead of the conversation, it may take more than that.
Right.
You may need to contribute more.
Yeah. And we did have that discussion at the last committee meeting that it may take more. Either CPA funds or whatnot from the town to get past the hump.
The feasibility piece.
Right.
Richard?
We talked a little bit about this a couple of days ago. The PCB had our meeting, so we have came to do this. We are concerned about the idea of the dollar sale. We're also interested in how much we can contribute with CPA on this stuff. One thought we had is that we go back and take our strategic plan and see how many dollars we can have for this topic per se, and get a look ahead in terms of where we can commit money out of our CPA accounts, and then try to fill in and do as much strategic work we can in those places. And there's a chunk of money going for this aspect or this aspect, we probably can fill some holes. Now, I had looked at the pro forma material we have. It's been around for about a year now, I guess. Mm-hmm. And I assume there's nothing new since those numbers.
Yeah.
I looked at the totals and how it looked kind of spread around. And it looks like it's about, I'm going to guess and probably not smart on this, but somewhere about $500,000 to $750,000 short in terms of cost projections and estimates and the dollars that are kind of sitting nearby us. So that me, I think to the rest of us, that's within range of making make it happen. Mm-hmm. The idea would be that the CPA part of it would be done by looking at how much total we have, how much we could commit over 5-10 years from the CPA pocket, and see if that's enough to fill the gap. Hmm. And then we have at least within the range of making it happen.
Okay.
And so our thought was is to get back together with our own strategies and what we'd be doing. We'd circle it on one of the things we do would be to see how much we can generate that support for. So we would have actually topics that we'd be supporting. Suppose it would be useful to have an incentive for senior people, and we could offer a dollar that goes with the completion of a unit.
Well, that's interesting. Yeah.
We'd use $10,000-$15,000 of CPA money to close the financial gap between what it's costing us and how it's going to shape up and what we have. So we sort of look for best fits and then award those over the years that we'll be doing this. Mm-hmm. And try to keep it in balance with our other CPA topics.
Right. Sir?
Yeah, just to piggyback on what Richard's saying, if you know, as you'll all recall, we only passed the initial in CPA investment by one vote.
Right.
You know, we can, to ask for another big chunk would be a pretty hard sell.
Sure.
The CPC has gotten pretty good in I don't know how many years, we've been doing this for 4 or 5 years, and we've figured out how to leverage funds and how to work things, and we would be interested in working this project in that way, in a leveraged way, using CPA funds to and taking the time to put together a financial package where we're leveraging funds to bring in other outside funds, looking for other sources. And leveraging, there's things that we could kind of sell more easily than other things. Like we could sell there being a first right of refusal for Sunderland residents. That's something that would give added value on top of what people have already voted for. So finding ways to add value to the investment we've already made would be helpful.
So when you talk about first right of refusal, you mean like a preference for Sunderland residents,
right,
in
exactly.
the rental
you
units?
You have that in the RFP
right.
as a preference, but that's the kind of thing that we would be willing to, mm-hmm. we could, or could probably Perfect. Sell paying more for
yep.
that asset.
Yeah. I just have to note that does have to comply with fair housing laws. And uh-huh. so it's for the initial housing lottery. You wouldn't be able to put a preference on a unit, for say. Like you can't say, you know, 5 of these units are forever going to be a preference for Sunderland uh-huh. residents. Uh-huh. So there are some things that would have to be looked at in terms of that.
Is there a way that we could make sure that, because we have a big issue in this town, mm-hmm. is that there's nowhere for
it's the reason we're doing it.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Well, I think typically what happens is, so the initial kind of lottery that would be done to kind of gather potential renters for the project, that can have a local preference, and so a certain percent of the units could be kind of go towards Sunderland residents, but then going forward you can't keep doing that. However, I think most when I go to affordable housing conferences and workshops and stuff, when you have a real need for it in your community, you're going to see a lot of local people filling those units anyways. It's not going to be people coming from very far away unless maybe they have kids who live in town or something. But in terms of the fair housing laws, you wouldn't be able to like set aside certain units just for Sunderland residents,
okay.
from my understanding.
Okay.
But
okay.
It's something that could be looked into more, but that's my kind of general understanding.
But under the umbrella of leveraging or matching, whether it's grant rounding or the commitment, I think that maybe the best leverage, having CPA is the best leverage, just having it available. You don't necessarily have to commit it. It's amazing what it does allow for inside of state and federal grant rounds.
Right.
It's like, oh, and you have matching funds, potentially.
Right.
The application tends to, you know, go through a different gate, if you will. Mm-hmm. So I think that's a wonderful way of describing it.
Yeah.
Great point.
And one other point I just want to make on top of that is when we sold this project, you know, we sold it as we're using CPA funds, and that means we're getting it for 50 cents on the dollar. Mm-hmm. And we have to be really careful in the financing of this transaction, that if we sell that piece for a dollar, mm-hmm. we have to do the finance, or hopefully do this finances in such a way that we're still using CPA funds to pay off what we owe on it.
Sure.
So we don't get in a position where we're kind of bait and switched.
Right.
People.
That's a great point, actually. Maybe that's the one synopsis to actually have is, like, let's avoid bait and switch at all costs.
Yeah.
Regardless of the mechanism. No way should it even have the illusion of a bait and switch.
Right.
Great point. Actually, I kind of like that. I can latch onto that. It's, like, really simple for me. Okay. Lauren, anything in the RFP itself that stands out that we missed through our wordsmithing or reviews?
I think there are two things that we definitely wanted people in the room to address. Mm-hmm. One was we wanted to be sure that the Conservation Commission was happy with the way that we direct the proposer to abide by the ruling of the Conservation mm-hmm. Commission. We want to make sure we got that right.
Yep.
The second is we have in there a little slippery language about whether the house remains part of the project or mm-hmm. is pulled out of the project. And the background on that is throughout the feasibility and market study process, we kind of heard it both ways. We heard it, this house is, you know, a problem, and but on the other hand, a developer wouldn't want to have a house be separate. So we kind of thought, why not leave it in there as an option, because, you know, our hope is that we're creating a project that someone will be interested in. I'd want to be sure, though, that should the developer go for Plan B, which is I don't want anything to do with the house, and then the town has to come up with a way to perhaps mm-hmm. Use it, and in some other way, still affordable, whether we have a zoning problem with it. So,
and maybe that's one of the leverage points. Right, there is maybe an opportunity there that says, hey, it's not really a bait and switch. By the way, we have the house in the very front end. We're going to do this with it. Great point. Great point, Lauren. So with respect to conservation, you know, there was a delineation. There was a passive delineation of what constituted the type of wetland. Berkshire Design did a very nice job, worked topically with the Conservation Commission about what kind, by definition, of wetlands it is, what could be constructed at, near, or relocated, etc. I thought the engineer at Berkshire Design did a very good job of explaining to the body of the 120 working group to say, well, you could in a federal law and a state law, but that's just really going to wind up, you know, the local folks, local overview body, and what we can and can't do with respect to that particular area of wetland. So let's be cognizant of that wetland area and the local Conservation Commission's oversight of that wetland area and its type, understand it, and work inside of that set of parameters. And I think that's essentially what you're describing, Lauren. Like, make sure that we're fully inclusive from the very, very beginning. That somebody doesn't get pushed off into a ditch somewhere. We recognize what kind of wetlands they are and how to operate in and around them.
And the language in the RFP is important to get clear, because if this will be a Chapter 40B project, a comprehensive permit project, then technically a developer doesn't have to abide by local wetlands ordinances or bylaws. They do have to abide by state wetlands. But I think, because what I understand is this is just falling under the jurisdiction of the local bylaw. So it's important to make sure we, if if you absolutely want someone who's answering to this to abide by that, then making it really clear what that means, and knowing ahead of time this is what we want.
So do we all feel that that's clear enough when they are
here? I don't think so.
Okay, yeah.
Perfect. That's why we're here.
And so...
It's workable, but it's not as clear as it could be to say that we, you know, for example, you could say, even though this is a town bylaw wetland, we want it treated as a state wetland.
Okay.
In the development process. That would be as clear as you could get.
Okay.
I see the wording changed a little bit, but it's... So the discussion, it's how is the wetland going to be handled? And the handling could be, we're going to ignore it and we're going to, you know, over drainage and everything and have a structure that can stay where it goes and not sink. And we'll have drainage that sends it somewhere else with stormwater and anything else that is a water issue. Mm-hmm. And it's engineerable and it's been done. So that's allowable, I think, in the way it's written now.
Okay.
So is it too opaque, the current language? Let me rephrase that. Is the current language acceptable for an RFP? And then is the language tightened up at the next level? Or should we have it tight in the very beginning? David?
I think the sooner you tighten it up, probably the better for everybody.
Yep. Activate and switch.
Right. It's like, here's our wetlands delineation. Mm-hmm. Here's what we want to abide by in the process, even though technically, you know, if you're going under 40B, as we've known in the past, you can get around that. But at least if we stipulate up front, these are our conditions, I think it'll make the process work that much better. Yeah.
Interesting.
Does the Conservation Commission want to provide some language, or should we drop something and send it to the Conservation Commission?
And for those, it's page 4F is what we're looking at. That's the language. Yes.
I think you could draft something.
Okay.
And bring it back, but it also didn't raise flags enough at our last meeting.
Sure.
Okay.
Warrant drafting something ourselves.
Okay. And we can take a look at, I realize we should probably take a look at the comparative evaluation criteria and maybe just make sure that that's as clear as well, because that's what we'll be evaluating them on. Okay.
What do you think for that, Alyssa, week to 10 days?
Oh, yeah. Okay. Well, we're going to gather, you know, input tonight, and then I can work on this in the next week, certainly.
Okay. So we have a placeholder in there under wetlands delineation, local bylaw, and how that applies to the RFP process, and that's an important placeholder. Anything else jump out, Lauren?
So I'd like to address the zoning.
Yep.
We divided into... Should the house be divided off, we'll now have two
non-conforming.
Right. Is that Steve? Is that a problem? Or under we can be able to?
Normally it would be, but somehow tying into a comprehensive permit in some fashion. That may be an avenue to. I mean, answers. I'm not sure.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you divide it, what would the use of that house be?
Good question.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's the other thing, too, because if it's CPA funds that were used, you have to consider that in terms of what you do with the house.
Right? That's a fall inside the category, so the applicable use of CPA money.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah. I think, because when we discussed this at the meeting, the consensus was we tried to change the language to kind of say that it's preferable not to divide it off because of these complications, but.
Great point. So in any case, we may end up certainly in front of the ZBA regardless, just because the nature of the project and then the potential for it to be split. And the split we've only held out, we're holding out as an option for the economics, really for the developer in a lot of ways.
Well, I did think we tried to weight it, even with the criteria, right, that if you included the house as part of the project, we got a lot more points. I think our concern is that we get someone versus no one. Mm-hmm. If we get someone who wants the house versus someone who doesn't want the house, mm-hmm, I think we would,
Great point. Comments with respect to, you had a question about zoning. Richard?
No, I was still back on the property exchange.
Okay. So the language on property exchange?
So on the document we have, section F, acquisition costs, just one sentence, there it says town is offering the property for sale. Sort of present tense language. Is that right? Starting the process of making it available? On page 7.
That's just part of this process.
So now, could there be a sentence added in terms of what we're trying to accomplish with the idea of the, selling the property?
And we'll just suggest, Richard, conceptually, not wordsmithing right now, but conceptually, so we can get maybe elicit the cog to work on that.
Well, the explanation of why giving the ownership of the property to the developer, why it's better than doing it another way.
So it's public record in general, the current assessed value and the purchase price. We know what that is. Is there reason to consider adding that language in here that says, you know, that the town is part of the history, purchased at blank and is financed at blank to this process, to this point in the process?
That's clarification.
Yeah, right. This is one piece of clarification. So it shows the town put skin in the game early and that there's value in the property. I see Sarah's wheels turning.
You find somebody that wants to buy it, and we have to sell what we have.
Right.
So we have a little bit of a cost for it to handle there.
Right. Interesting.
What is your preference, that it would be leased, or?
I don't know. I just know that we have about,
it's option, like a 99-year lease.
$100,000 to spend on the property. We still owe for over 7 years, I believe. So we got to make it clear what's going to happen there.
Right.
That's actually a good point, because I know that towns like Seattle, I think, and maybe in Portland in the Northwest, have done things like that with housing, where rather than purchasing it or selling it, the town will retain ownership, and then they work on like 99-year leases, essentially, with the what become essentially tenants. So it's a slightly different approach to land ownership, but it's something that seems to be working pretty well.
Yeah.
So that's the way to look at it.
Yeah. So we have a transaction to go over here, eventually, in terms of selling the property.
Right.
You may want to look into that and kind of figure out the timing and what the principal things have to be that are.
Good point.
Go ahead. Maybe one or two sentences
to
explain what we're trying to do here.
Okay. I can try to do something. And then about the lease, if you wanted to leave it as an option, you could do that as well.
Yes, that's
you
very
could
good point.
Say that, you know, to see what developers would be more interested in. I have no idea.
Sarah?
Oh, yeah, I guess more
I'm just,
options.
I just wanted to ask about the kind of negotiation strategy here, like putting your cards out on the table right off out front, saying we're selling it for $1. Why put that in? Why not just see what kind of proposals people come up with, you know, instead of just.
I think the easy answer is the economics showed that to purchase the purchase price of the property by a developer would push it past the, you know, profitability scales. That's the easy answer.
Right.
That doesn't mean there's not a little work in there that's important.
Did we do that with the Blue Heron? The same thing? Like, wasn't that
the
similar
value
thing?
Yeah.
But why not leave? I'm just saying, why not leave it to the people who are proposing to do their own calculations and propose to us? Why put our cards out on the table like
that's
that?
That's a good point, actually.
And the other thing I was wondering is, does that pro forma go out as part of the package?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Because it
it's
has
an
to?
Attachment.
Yeah. That's considered a something you have to have in order to even advertise something.
I see. Okay. Because I think it has something in there about $365,000 in CPA funds. And I just had a concern about that because, I mean, we can't pre-commit CPA funds
right.
by any means. I mean, that's something that's got to be sold to town meeting.
Sure.
And, so I guess it just kind of felt like,
I thought that the money it showed in CPA funds was the value of the house.
Might be the value of the house, but it's not what we contributed.
We got a pretty good deal. $245,000.
I'm not remembering
the 365. As I recall, it was just north of 260 plus thousand
right.
after interest
including
born.
Interest.
Yep. Yep.
Yeah, somewhere in there.
Yeah.
It says 365,000.
Hmm. Okay. We'll drill down on that and make sure it's correct.
Yeah, and we also want to make sure, is that's including what we've already committed? That's not
Yeah, be total value.
CPA.
Great point, though. I want to circle back to your comment, if I could, Sarah. Stuart, you've been in these on the municipal side. And I keep going back to your sitting almost camouflage against that green backdrop, by the way. Thank God for just sitting a little off to the right. That said, is it not common or common to incorporate the cost of transfer of property for a nominal fee on the front side? Or is it really, go ahead.
Well, if that's the intent of the community, mm-hmm. was that their contribution in the property,
okay.
then I think you would put that up front. If I did have a question based on Sarah's comment,
sure.
if you're gonna take that away or leave it open, mm-hmm. are you willing to leave it open in the other direction as well, which is clearly not your intent,
mm-hmm.
but you would find out from the developer what the shortfall is up front.
Oh, I see.
You know, if on Sarah's side, which would be the good side, how much are you willing to pay us for the land?
Yep.
But the realistic side is probably how much do you see it's going to cost beyond our donation of the land?
Got it.
Which, you know, we've asked for that information throughout the RFP anyway.
Right.
We're going to get that information. But I don't know if you want to be brave enough to say, yes, we'll do this project, but only if you give us $100,000 more in CPA funds. And then, mm-hmm. then you have to figure out what to do with that.
So let me ask a question under the acquisition cost, right? We've heard purchase and we've heard lease. Would it make sense, or does it make sense to have under this page 7F acquisition cost, the town is offering the property for sale. Stop. And then let the offer come in? If someone comes in and says for a dollar?
Well, I think you have to change the process slightly so that there would be the price proposal
yep.
would be separate from
I see.
The rest of it.
Oh, you're right, right.
Mm. So you would have to just
got it.
Change the
two tiers.
Yeah, the
two
RFP types. To include that.
Price sure. and non-price proposal.
What are your thoughts? Having gone through a couple of these yourself, what do you think?
I would defer to the committee and the board.
Okay.
It's a community project, so.
Good point. Richard, what do you think with respect to that, adding a tier, essentially a bid piece, and then the RFP piece?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't have a good answer on
that one. Okay. Interesting. So we have a piece of homework with respect to how to go about that, right? I think Sarah, I think rightly so, you know, putting cards on the table, I heard. I think another easy thing to get my brain wrapped around. Interesting. Lauren, do you think that... Hey, Liz.
I was just trying to understand a little more about if the house gets peeled off, mm-hmm. does the CPA money get allocated sort of on a per acre basis or on a value basis, or can it be all allocated one way or the other?
Mm-hmm.
And does that make a difference?
Sure, that's a really good question as well. So dollar values. it would be interesting actually to say, you know, we're selling the back lot for a dollar, consideration of a dollar, and the CPA money is held for the very front, whether it's historic preservation, housing, recreation. Interesting. It's a good way. It's an interesting way of looking at it if that ends up being in the developer's wheelhouse. So we don't want the house. We're not interested. We want a right of way, and we want that space in the back. Go ahead, Lauren.
Pat has a good file here, and she just handed me three different versions of the budget at LDS. And I'm having trouble recalling exactly how they did this, but I think that there are different versions that show different contributions from the town and different also factor in the developer kind of, like money's coming in from the developer, but money's being contributed from the town. So I'm not sure that these weren't done more as an exercise to show, you know, if A then B, if B then C, rather than saying this is what we're offering. I think what we're offering, I think we did a bunch of this, we prepared a bunch of this financial, we had a consultant prepare a bunch of this financial information to help a developer develop their own budget to let us know for, so that they can figure out what's feasible. I don't think that this stuff commits us to anything in particular. I think what we say in the RFP commits us to what we're contributing. I think it was fairly clear that this project is not viable if we don't pony up the land. So my personal opinion is we make it as straightforward as possible. That there are already a lot of peculiarities about this piece of land, and we're shoehorning it in, and it's not the easiest property to develop. There's a lot of wetlands. You've got to have a long road to get to not that many units. There's a lot of, you know, it's a great location. It's not ideal for development.
Sure.
So I think the more complicated we make it, the less options we're going to have.
Okay.
That's my feeling.
That's a really good point, actually.
Right, from a developer standpoint.
And it's important to bear in mind, those scenarios from LDS, there was a fair amount of skepticism with respect to their total values, cost per units, et cetera.
Yeah, we were skeptical about a lot of it in reverse.
Right.
I mean, essentially, no one is going to get out their checkbook based on someone else's numbers.
Right.
Those numbers are going to help someone start figuring out their own numbers.
Right.
And
right.
None of this works without a ton of state programs, grant money, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Straight money, it does not work.
Right, right. Yeah, we heard that. You know, there's a threshold of total number of units that help, and then beyond the total number of units, cost of construction. Again, it's economics. It's that fun world. Interesting. No, but I think the feedback about value and language are really important to bear in mind. And then I think we have to go back to the actual basics. If I could reiterate a point. All of this is being driven by the goal to increase our housing stock that's on the state list for affordable housing units. We want to ensure that our housing units, we recognize our housing plan has been approved and that we're implementing that said housing plan. This is an important piece in said housing plan. Those units don't come off the rolls ever again, and that's a good thing. So, you know, shows our housing production plan actually moving forward. But the areas of concern tonight, I think, expressed so far, one about the tightening up the language around page 4F, which has to do with the wetlands and keeping the local view on the wetlands, is really, really important. We'll get that piece of homework out. And then a couple, I think, sentences and maybe some framework in italics for discussion about the acquisition costs. Lauren, I deeply value your opinion on this with respect to the cost of conveyance of the property. That's an important component to making it successful. At the same time, the town has ponied up money right out of CPA money. So how do we avoid the view of that bait and switch? You gave it away for a dollar. Is that dollar still back here? No, it's gone. It's downstairs. We used to have the dollar for the blue heron behind us. And actually, there's a really interesting, you know, for people who were associated with that project, remember that, you know, we did the RFP, we did the feasibility studies, we were looking at over $1 million worth of work to make it effectively habitable. And the blue heron got it for a dollar. We accepted their bid, and they put in well over that money, and nearly a decade later, or decade later now, we see what that happened to be. A property that was not on the tax roll, that is on the tax roll, that's a viable business. I mean, the delta between year one and year four are just dramatic. So I think that's important to bear in mind. The town does make a commitment on these things and accepts a fair amount of risk. Stuart, you had a comment you wanted to circle back around? You're good. So we covered the area you were concerned about a couple minutes ago?
Yep. And I do strongly support what Lauren just said. Mm-hmm. A simple statement like Alyssa has prepared,
yep,
I think is really helpful.
Okay.
I mean, I think if you decide you want to go for the lease, but I wouldn't have it as an option.
Right.
I think you lease
pick
use
one.
And we
yeah.
do one,
mm-hmm,
and we make it clear.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, either way, I think that it's unrealistic to think that the cost of the land isn't our contribution to this project to make it happen. I think we could consider negotiate whether we're willing to put any other money into it.
Right.
But I think to think that we're not putting the cost of the land into it is really unrealistic.
Okay. Anyone else with respect to the RFP? It's not that much homework, is it?
No, this was really helpful. Thank you. No, it's great.
Okay, anything else with respect to 120 North Main? If not, we have a date with the library trustees, director. Thanks so much, everybody, for participating with this. I appreciate it. Our timeline for this, Alyssa, we have a little bit of homework, and our goal was to target late summer?
Yeah, definitely, because we, because the grant that's funding my work
yep.
ends in December.
It'll be built by then.
So yeah, I'll get on this because I'll be out of at the end of the month for mm-hmm. a week. So I'll try to get the revisions back to you
okay.
within the next week.
Great. Thanks so much for all your
Thank
help
you.
On this. I deeply appreciate it. And thanks everybody for the comments. Thanks so much. Okay. Catherine Hand, Library Director, is going to talk about long range planning.
So,
come on up. They all sat in the back. What do you think? You got a long-range plan. It's a beautiful brick building that's well-attended, and you want to make it even better attended.
Exactly. Well, the goal of the long-range plan is to, it's to establish our goals and services mm-hmm. for the next 5 years as yep. far ahead as we can, imagine them. Obviously, things are going to change. We
sure.
leave room for flexibility, but it's a really nice process for me to go through. In that, it's a good way for me to get to know the community. We've been soliciting a lot of community input through surveys, both in paper and online. I did two community input sessions, and then the reason for my being here now is to make sure that the selectmen and the town have a chance to give their input as well for what you think the library should be. Because that's the whole point of this is, Sunderland's library. I want to make sure that we're doing what Sunderland wants.
Appreciate that. So could I ask a question? Not
yes.
so much about the plan, but about the process.
Yes.
What was the funnest thing you heard about the library from the public?
The funnest
good
thing?
Yeah.
Lots of good things. But the biggest thing is pretty much everyone's favorite thing about the library is the staff. And I cannot stress that enough. When people say what they like about the library is they like the staff. The staff are really kind to them. The staff are really patient. The staff go out of their way to serve them well. And that's definitely something I see as well. So it's definitely a point in, one of our goals would be to retain our staff and to make sure they're adequately trained and happy.
And so the feedback from the public, any other gems that came out? I see hours in here. That makes perfect sense. Right?
Yes.
Technology. Pressure on technology?
I'm surprised not so much. We got new computers this year. People are really happy with that. There has been a request for more technology classes, which is something I'm working on.
That's interesting.
Offering. So learning how to download ebooks from the library.
Yeah.
I'll be
like that.
Teaching those classes as well.
Huh.
I was kind of surprised by that, but it's definitely something that is going to be part of it. We need to maintain technology and to stay advanced in it. And a new point that a goal that I'm adding is making sure that staff receive adequate training in technology as well.
Mm-hmm.
That is something that I have fallen behind in, is that they're expected to know how to do all these things, but with the myriad of devices out there, there's no way they can really keep on top of it with what they're doing now.
So is there a risk in trying to keep up? I'd say this is a general statement as someone who's got one of those and another one of those, and the thing that flips up, and all supposed to be on one unit, right? It doesn't always work that way.
Yeah. So the way that I'm framing it is, mm-hmm. you know, one of my little goals is to watch what other libraries are doing, make sure it works for them, and then see if it'll work in Sunderland.
Smart.
That's kind of my policy with everything. It's let the big guys deal with it first, and then if it works, we try it out on our scale.
Okay. They've got the budget to play around. So
exactly.
To an extent.
Yeah. And yeah, that's part of my goal too, is to make sure that I'm well budgeted to make sure we can maintain a high level of service. So, you know, having a plan for when we do need to replace all of our computers so we're not cleaning house every 10 years.
Maybe. Well, and hopefully this is one of the things we've been trying to push for a while too, is to get some kind of shared either purchasing or leasing that's beyond just the library, the town hall, like maybe bring in the schools or something like that so that we can get a little more bang for our buck.
That would be great.
You know, and maybe look at like leasing or something like that, like a lot of companies do. So you're not buying it and then it's obsolete, you know, 2 years later, you know. So that way when your lease runs out, you're just swapping it up for something else, you know.
Yeah, I'd something be very interested in working with you guys on that if that is something the town's interested in.
Yeah, because, I mean, you know, in 2 years, you've seen how quickly the technology changes. And I think it's interesting because of the changing role of libraries, you know, and how that's kind of evolving too. So it's interesting to see how people are evolving with it. So
yeah.
Still important. It's just a different role
exactly.
than maybe it was, you know, 100 years ago or whatever. So.
So if I could, Catherine, I see scattered throughout the goals and objectives piece. This is 2011, 2012 in some cases, 2013.
Yes.
This is the current
yeah,
strategic,
so this is the current
and we're going to update it.
Long-range plan that we're updating. So it expires this year.
Great.
And so a lot of what my goals are, you know, a lot of those things we have completed. So I'm adding new things in, but a lot of the basic services we want to keep. This is a good long-range plan, what we were working with before. So.
Sure.
And another point from the survey is that people really appreciate that the library is a community center here in town. They love our programming and they want to see more of it, especially more programs for adults. We do a lot of great stuff for kids, but senior citizens is a target area that we're not doing enough for. So I like to increase what we're doing for them and for adults, activities for parents to do while their kids are at library and things. So these are ideas that I'm mulling over and want to improve.
Thanks.
And I've also, some other changes are reaching out to more community organizations. We have North Star now, so we have all these points. We're working with the schools. I've been really lucky so far to have a good relationship with them and to collaborate on a couple different projects, so I really want to continue that. And with any other town organizations, I really want to push outreach as an important aspect of what the library should offer.
Architectural workshops. On small lots.
There you go.
A 40B workshop.
What to do with that small lot?
That small lot. So outside of the input from the board, what's the timeline for our homework to be complete? Because we don't want to miss our homework.
So I'm working on a draft now, and essentially it's going to be approved at the September meeting of the Board of Trustees, hopefully, so we can stay on goal. The reason for the deadline is that in order to qualify for LSTA grant funding from the state, you have to have a current long-range plan on file, and I don't want to miss a year of that.
Right. That makes really good sense as someone who's participated in the housing production plan. It's like, oh.
There's timelines.
Yeah, so if you guys could give feedback, you know, as you have it, and even if your feedback doesn't go into the long-range plan specifically, that doesn't mean I don't want to hear it. Another new goal that I'm going to, specific line I want to put in there is having a better, more communicative relationship with the Board of Selectmen. You know, one of my trustees mentioned having, like, quarterly meetings like this, just quick updates.
Yeah, that's good.
I think it would be really, really helpful for both of us to
going forward with the season.
And the public, too, because, you know, they get to see, you know, it's like a public quarterly update, really, in that respect. So,
the last thing that we would like to have happen is the library function and a library, an active library group feel that it's separate from the town, or the town feel that it's somehow, and I say the town, a collective, people who don't use the library or support the library at particular levels feel that it's somehow some outlier or a department or whatever, as I said at the beginning of the meeting.
No, it's definitely not something we want to see. Like I said before, it's a town library, so we need to reflect the sentiments of the town, even if it's town members who don't necessarily come to the library. need to, we're trying to reach out to people who don't visit the library. You know, obviously the survey, it's people who are visiting sure. and using the library. So a committee member and I, who've been working on this long range plan, we're going to go stand out in front of the millstone.
Nice.
Hopefully in the next couple of weeks, get people as they're doing some shopping.
There you go.
That used to be one of the places we would post a warrant.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was like, it had to be at the millstone, the corner store, the post office, and the town office building. Why? Because, well, those are the two traffic centers. Yep. It's just the way it is. Everybody goes there. Well, I certainly appreciate the legwork and bringing this forward for us to continue to review and participate in. And the invitation to participate is something that we will not take lightly. So
yes, and the trustees and I are having a special meeting to talk about the new goals, and that's next Tuesday, July 19th, I believe is the date, and that's at 7 p.m. at the library. And so it's an open meeting, so yeah. Anyone's welcome to attend, selectmen, town people, anyone who wants to come.
Perfect. Perfect. I sure appreciate that. Any questions, David, or comments, Sherry?
Not right now. No.
Strategic planning is something that, you know, we talk about the difference between politics and governance. Governance is this kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, that's the framework of what we're built on. Good job.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
We'll see you at 7. The 19th at 7 at the Sunderland Public Library. Worth going to. Okay, I'm going to hold off on minutes until Tom is back. We have two sets here. Tom is actually out right now. I'm sure the fish are afraid. We'll leave it right at that. Dan, what do you think about the 300th activity?
I just wanted to run something by all of you so that sure. everybody's informed. I met with Tom and the 300th committee on June 9th. Huh? And they asked me about put together a tribute for the 300th for honoring town veterans, which I don't have a problem doing. One of the things they wanted to do is a flyover as a culmination event, and I mm-hmm. think that's doable. The concern I have, though, is you know, what we typically do, what we've done since 2009, is we have the military out here in the Memorial Wall area. And they do some drilling ceremonies, and there's a guest speaker, and then all the military go back to the school with the mm-hmm. kids. And that's before Veterans Day, because that day is a holiday. Yep. And so it typically, in one year it occurred after the day, but every other year it's been before the day. The 300th wants to do it actually on Veterans Day, which would take it out of the realm that it has been in.
Yeah.
And so, you know, it was envisioned by Tim Merritt. He's the one that started it in 2009 as an event for Sunderland school children. And so I just want to make sure that if that's what we are going to do, that the town agrees. I know that the military, one of the reasons that the event has grown in popularity with the military is because they enjoy the interaction with the kids yeah. afterwards.
Right.
Right. You don't want to essentially lose that.
That's right. And yeah. and so it would be them coming out to perform some drilling ceremonies huh. and then, you know, maybe stay and participate in some of the celebration, but it wouldn't have the same flavor, and the kids would not have it that year. So I think it's something we need to seriously
yeah.
consider.
Right. What would the benefits of changing it to Veterans Day actually be, other than
having it on
the day?
You lose that other half. You know, many of the residents will participate in the ceremony, and then they go about their business or their form of celebration.
Right.
Meanwhile, you go back to the school, the veterans, the active service members will go back to the school, participate in the elementary school. That's an important piece of feedback, and it does in some ways differentiate what the town of Sunderland does mm-hmm. compared to the communities, versus just right. color guard, honor guard,
right.
ceremony return.
I don't mind trying to set it up if that's what we decide that we want. Personally, I think it needs to stay in the school.
Yeah.
But that's my own personal bias.
No, it's
I would agree with that, because, you know, you're bringing in the next generation of people who are going to celebrate this and learning about what it's all about, really.
Right. Well, and it's really, I mean, I know that I've talked to you about it before, but it's really instructive, even to me after 7 years of doing it, to be in the classroom with the kids and the questions that they come up with.
Oh, yeah.
I mean,
right.
It's just amazing, you know, and very thoughtful. They're not, except for some of the boys who, you know, want to know if you've ever carried a dying buddy off the battlefield, but... But there are some very thought-provoking questions in this, and you know, I think the kids, if they don't have that, that's something that is, there's a lot of value in that.
So it sounds like we had a little tension between the original intent,
right,
and then the 300th,
right,
and in that tension, it would be in some ways. Lost opportunity to take a year off, mm-hmm. right? To consolidate the two events into one thing. You raise a really good point.
Well, I just want to, you know, before I proceed with it,
right.
I have to go out to the base to talk to, there's a new wing commander yep. out there, and I need to go talk to him about mm-hmm. the event so yep. that they'll continue to support it.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to go see the fire chief while I'm out there for the 300th to see if I can get some of the fire... Westover has some very amazing fire yeah. prevention stuff.
Totally.
See if I can get that out here as part of that event.
Hmm.
But I didn't want to sit down and talk to the wing commander and say, you know, this is what we've been doing and this is what we'd like to do for the 300th. I do like the idea of a flyover as a culmination event. I mean, mm-hmm. that's easy enough to arrange. It's just I have to start far enough out
right.
to know exactly what day that we're going to do it on.
Yep.
But I'm assuming it would be Veterans Day.
Sure. So. Boy, at first blush, Dan, first of all, thanks for all the work in the last more than half a dozen years doing this. At first blush, boy, I think the notion of losing the opportunity to interact at the elementary school is a greater loss than the notion of celebrating the town's 300th with some kind of presence. So I tend to share your initial concern right off the bat. Now, I know there's a bunch of logistics going on with respect to the planning for the 300th. Mm-hmm. Maybe at that group's next meeting, we could bring this forward and say, listen,
yeah.
it doesn't make any sense.
Right.
I mean, part of the success is when the service men and women return.
Right.
After the elementary school.
Right.
That's a big deal.
Sure.
Hmm. Yep. And it kind of speaks to, you know, service members reintegrating back into
yeah.
society and everything in that respect, and, you know, when
good
they
point.
Come back in.
Full loop.
Yeah, that's all kind of tied
great
to that.
Points.
Well, that was it. I just
go ahead,
wanted
Jennifer.
To, I just wanted to bring that forward. So.
Okay. Well, we got to follow up with that. Jennifer?
I just feel the need to contribute. I hope I'm not overstepping.
Now, get right in there.
Say that event as a parent
yeah.
is one of our favorite school events that happens.
Nice.
My son's 9, so he's benefited. We started going before he was in the school.
He hasn't asked that question about, you know.
No,
oh, good.
Mainly, you know, open it up to the older kids.
Okay.
But in terms of those kinds of questions. But it's so rewarding, and
mm-hmm.
I would feel lost if it
yeah.
happened on a day when the school children couldn't participate fully in that event. And I know that there'll be other 300th, I'm also on the 300th committee that was not at that meeting,
yeah.
so I would have said this.
Sure.
There's going to be other events for the children
mm-hmm.
for the 300th, but it's not really set in stone yet what
right.
those events are. But I feel very personally strongly that it should stay. On the day my children.
Yeah, that was my concern.
Yep.
So.
So I would suggest that going out on a limb, since there's the two of us, and maybe you're looking for some guidance, let's not compromise the interaction with the elementary school for the 300th.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I think that's really an important community feature.
I do too. Well, I will look at arranging a flyover.
Sure.
Rather than, you know, we were going to try to do one this year.
Yep.
But if I do one this year, then getting one for the 300th.
Right. Right.
So.
Now, I think that makes good sense.
Yeah.
We'll focus on that for the 300th, but keep Tim's initiative alive.
Sure. All right, great.
Thanks so much, Dan. I appreciate that a great deal.
Thanks.
Jennifer, I appreciate your comments. That's a, you know, we're all in many ways parents, but our kids are our own children are beyond that at this point, and your input was instrumental. Thanks. Nah, that's it. You're off.
Well, when you look at it, that's what the whole 300th is about, is celebrating the town and everything. And
correct.
This is an integral part of, you know, it's become a very important town tradition in that respect.
I agree. It's such fun. Okay, next up, we get some appropriation transfers. Wait a minute. Hey. It's July 11th.
Right on time.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Exactly. Thanks. There's the voice of reason again.
TikTok.
All right. So how many? One? That's actually not so bad.
Just one.
Yep. All right. And for folks who are watching, appropriation transfers are allowed inside of departments or across expense budgets. They were part of a statute for Community Fiscal Relief Act of 10 or 12 years ago now. Actually, the Romney administration, believe it or not, they did some good things. They allowed us to stretch this out past up to the 15th, as I recall, or the 20th. Anyway, get through kind of cleaning up our books at the end of the year. We have in front of us a request from Treasure Collector. Who is it from, Sherry?
It's from the Treasurer.
Yeah. So we're looking for $72. And the account that we're looking to appropriate has 8413. That's getting right down there, isn't it?
Yep.
All right. I forget which year it was, but it was crazy balancing of like under $4 just to close the year out.
Get it all cleaned up. Yep.
David, you see any challenges with this?
Well, there appears to be enough money in there. So
short-term interest is $2,000, and we're looking to take $72 out of it, and it's going to
collector's expense bucket, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
David, any questions or concerns?
No, I think that's all right.
If not, is there a motion?
Make a motion to approve the request for appropriation transfers from the collector treasurer.
Okay, we have a motion, a second, for $72 to clear up a line, balance a line for the treasure collector's expense. All those in favor?
Aye.
2-0, please. Okay. I'm looking for that agenda. I found it. David, you got any updates?
There's things in progress, but nothing to be updated on this week. So.
Well played. Well played. Okay, the only thing I'll add is that the this 120 North Main Working Group has been at it for some time now. The COG has done really good work, in particular Alyssa and her director have helped us quite a bit. We are, of course, on our summer schedule, as you know. We have the chief of police candidate meetings between my schedule and Eric Demetropoulos' schedule. We're looking at sometime after the 14th to get back together, start talking, or get together initially to start talking. And then we'll have an update from there. Sherry, besides moving the office around, which is awesome, by the way.
Yeah.
It's quite a difference.
That's a heck of a difference. Any updates?
Thank you to everyone involved in that move. There was a lot of people, Cindy and Teresa and George and Nick and Wendy and everybody for making that a huge success. It is nice and open and airy and all of those things. So we're looking at different ways to improve efficiencies in the office and do some cross-training and pitching in to help each other cover vacation time, sick time, and those things. So the office move is part of that greater plan, and another part of improving those efficiencies will be the new upgraded telephone service to the VoIP, Voice Over Internet protocol. So we're looking forward to all of those things. And
so is that timeline for proposals coming? I mean, it's after the first of the year, so we can write those proposals out, right?
Yeah, we can start that. We did get the grant, the information technology grant. You have signed the contract. The board has it's back in the, we're waiting for the state to sign and send it back, but we can certainly start the process. So I'll be working on that.
Nice.
And I'm working on putting together a year-end fiscal year 16 project status update.
Nice.
And working with the board's committees, commissions, and department heads to develop an action plan for fiscal year 17. And we'll be looking forward to updating the board's goals on the 25th.
Oh, no. We have goals?
It's that time.
Oh. Lacey, you didn't tell me we had goals. We have goals. All right, good.
Actually, it does remind me of one thing. The personnel committee met tonight, basically planning out our year in terms of what we want to do. So,
good.
Sort of a follow up on the stuff that we did last year and kind of finalizing that. So, we'll be doing comparative surveys of pay and things like that, and trying to look at all of them too to see. You know, we've got what, three different ones, I think, and. I'm curious. I'm going to be curious to see what each one deems the comp towns to be and everything. Because if we get three things back with totally different things, you know, and one of the things I want to make sure too is this is that we, you know, for posterity's sake, if nothing else, for our own memories, you know, it's like 3 years down the road, we come up with whatever set of comp towns, and these are what we're going to use. We need to document and. Remember where we put that documentation, like why we picked these towns, because
the comp towns set the stage for the decision.
Exactly.
And that's really an important, people lose sight of that. I mean, we could pick Hopkinton and Provincetown.
Right. And
not germane to our discussion at all.
Right.
You know? And comp towns can weight the decisions forward for some time to come. So you're absolutely right. That's a really important kind of base information to have.
Right. Here's what we've picked, and here's why we've picked them.
Right,
even
right.
more importantly, so that you know, we want to come to agreement there, so that we remove that piece from the equation, so that then we're focusing on you know what we've got to do as far as that goes. So
good.
We'll see how that goes.
An active board's a good thing. So we have a historical commission reappointment. It looks like maybe we might have missed one here at the end of the year, or this is new. Let's see. David, what do you got?
All right. For my best Muppet News voice here. This is to the Sunderland Select Board from Linda LePac. I should do that in that voice, but...
The eagle, I could just see the...
Some eagle!
Exactly, the plumage.
To Sunderland Select Board from Linda LePaca, Chair of the Sunderland Historical Commission, regarding reappointment recommendations. The Sunderland Historical Commission recommends that Cindy Benjamin and Linda LePaca be reappointed to the Historical Commission. Their three-year term would be from 2016 to 2019. If you have any questions or need additional information regarding our recommendation, please contact me.
Okay.
And I won't read her phone number over the air.
Both very, very dynamic and committed to this particular environment. So,
much appreciated.
Any particular issues at all. David, do you have a motion?
I motion to reappoint as recommended.
So, this is a 3-year appointment from 16 to 19 for Linda LePaca and Cindy Benjamin. All those in favor?
Aye.
2-0, please. And thank you both of you for your work on that.
Yes.
Okay. Sherry, what else can we stretch out tonight? What do you think? Lacey, what do you think? 9 o'clock tonight? No. I get an official no from the back. Okay. Well, I would suggest again that we pay attention to the fabric of our society. That said, is there a motion to adjourn?
Motion.
I'll second the motion to adjourn. All those in favor?
Aye.
Call us out. 2-0, please call us out at 7:49. Thank you, Lacey. I appreciate it.